confidence that as Muslims, we are willing to present the ayat of the Quran and the instructions of the Prophet and listen to them together and understand them together. If I may slip and make a mistake, responsibility to correct it, and if I say the truth, that's the bounty of the law, which I am grateful for. Today the Muslim Ummah is living on the verge of a new reality. For the past decades and centuries, the Muslims have been followers of rules and of values and ideas that were dictated to them. Today, there is a will that permeates the Muslims from Senegal to Somalia, from Mongolia to Cape Town. And this is the crux of the issue of our existence in this world. If we were denied our will power and the faculty to reason, then we wouldn't have been accountable in the presence of Allah. But it is within the parallel of thinking and willing something that we are held accountable for the ultimate responsibility that was designated to us in the Quran as al-khilaf. Allah says to the heavenly presence around him, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. I am indeed to create on earth a khalifa. Are they the animals or are they the trees? Are they lifeless or lively beings? This Khalifa, the consensus of Muslim opinions, is me and you, the human species that Allah has given life, is this Khalifa in this world. And everything else belongs to the will of Allah. It is not within the will of the moon to depart from its course of motion. It is not within the will of the planets to take off on their own. All of them follow strict regulations and sunnah which Allah gave to them. They had no choice but to do so. But there's one element in existence, in life, in the universe, that was given a dimension not given to others, not even the angels. Allah describes the angels as creatures who do not disobey Allah in what He commands them, and they do what they are told to do. لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. So it is us, the people of this world, who are left with the task of administering this earth according to the system that Allah Jalla wa Ala presented to man throughout the ages. This system, and it is very significant in the Quran, that many ayat dwell on previous previous experiences and developments in the history of humanity, that our attention is drawn in the Quran most extensively to the experience of Bani Israel. The person who is to follow the ayat in the Quran that speak about Bani Israel will find a divine light that is being shed for us in order to avoid the pitfalls and the mistakes that were deliberately committed by Bani Israel throughout their history and their encounters with their different apostles and prophets. The ayat that speak about Bani Israel in the Quran, by and large, are of political nature. There's a political significance to these ayat, as well as other ayat in the Quran. In addition to ayat in the Quran that speak about the economic factor in man's life, who has heard of the repetition of the word man in the Quran? وَآتُوهُم مِّن مَالِ اللَّهِ الَّذِي مستخلفين فيه. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. إنما أموالكم وأولادكم فتنة. الذي جمع مالا وعدده. And the many other ayat in the Quran that refer to the function of wealth and money and to its relationship with the will that we are accountable for. You have a will. You have a choice to determine whether you will accept Allah's orders or whether you will not accept them. This choice hasn't been given to the stones or to the trees. It was only given to you. And it was only given in a certain dimension in life. Even your will doesn't have access to many, to most of the vital realities and facts in life. You cannot come today and command your stomach to stop digesting, regardless of how awesome your willpower is. So there's an area in which the will of man works. And the system that Allah subhanahu presented to us is a system that addresses the issue of working man's will within the dimensions that were granted to him. People have the will to exploit. People have the will to be greedy. People have the will to accumulate capital. People have the will to dislocate power. People have the will to try to appoint themselves divine beings in this world. And this is the ultimate shirk that Allah subhanahu will not forgive. If we can focus our attention on this area and understand that this is our function and responsibility, we can build forth an understanding of the Quran as it addresses with its many ayat the function of our will that is not working in a vacuum, because there are other wills in this world. Discrimination is not a fact of life that is born with a human being. No one is born with a natural inclination towards racial prejudice. But there is a will that is structured in our lives that makes this fact a feature of our daily lives around us, something that we can all relate to, especially in the context here in Cape Town and in South Africa. Why has this type of determination taken hold? Why did it take hold of life around us? Obviously, because of the absence of our will as Muslims. If we had the willpower to execute the many directives in the Quran that equalize the human being with his brother and sister human beings, we would not have the features of life that we have today that is affecting our own judgments at times, maybe subliminally, maybe consciously. The accumulation of capital, is it the will of Allah Most High, Most Supreme? Is it His will that people should be born rich and others should be born poor? No one is born with a check in his hand or with a treasure. But nevertheless, as human life develops, we find that there are those segments in society that have accumulated capital. They have accumulated capital to such a degree that they have fashioned themselves as deities in our lives. Who can challenge or think about challenging the motions that are set forth in our lives by these capitalists? And using the word capitalist and capital brings me to a gray area in the contemporary mind of the Muslims. Sometimes these words are alien. They shouldn't be used. Well, of course, if a person wants to reduce this type of logic, then he would come out saying that the English language itself should not be used, and we should be communicating here in Arabic. But obviously, if that was the case, we would alienate a lot of people who wouldn't understand what we are saying in the language of the Quran. So, being that we did use the English language to begin with, we have to use also the terminologies and the words that are part of this language. But in an Islamic context, we don't borrow the connotations of these words from the non-Muslims. When I say capitalists, or when I say the oppressed, these words are not drawn from the political left in this world. They are only used to relate an idea to you, an idea that has been distancing itself from Muslim life for a long time. Who here can quote from the Quran ayat that have the words mutrafeen in them, or have the words mustakbireen in them, or have the words mustad'afeen in them, or aradiluna in them? We are conventionally and traditionally brought up within a triangle of three, basically, three concepts. There is a mu'minun, there is a munafiqun, and there is a kafirun. But the terminology in the Quran that breaks down these meanings for us, like the word al-mutrafeen, like the word al-mustakbireen, al-musta'leen, aradiluna, al-mustad'afeen, these are words that are common in the Quran and also common in the hadiths of the Prophet. Allah alayhi wa sallam. But even though they are common, when we try to make the language of the Quran relevant to the world around us, somehow these words are not present. Let me just strike a couple of examples here. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِّن نَذِيرٍ إِلَّا قَالَ مُتْرَفُوهَا إِنَّا بِالَّذِي أُرْسِلْتُمْ بِهِ كَافِرُونَ. It never fails. Every time we send an apostle or a messenger to a society, the affluent in that society say that we are Kafirs.
Of the Muslims when they cease to take the meanings of these ayat in the Quran
function in reality. And so along came the Marxists, and they hijacked these meanings and gave them their own words. Instead of using a Mustafi, they said proletariat. Instead of using a Mustakbiri, they said, or a Mutrafi, they said capitalists. And the very different shades of these two words. And then they built their whole theory around this and presented it to man as a savior from the economic and political and social dislocations that exist in our societies. Now, when a Muslim wants to come and take a closer look at the Quran and try to revive these meanings, of course, there are those orders who come along and say, this is a leftist interpretation of the Quran, and it has nothing to do with leftism. It has nothing to do with rightism. It only has something to do with the sincere and practical understanding of the Quran. Let me present to you the question. What is the meanings of these ayat in the Quran that speak about al-mutrafin and al-mustakbirin? What are their meanings in the present life circumstances that we find ourselves in? No one has advanced an explanation for these meanings coming from an Islamic background, and hence the effort was left up to those thieves who were stealing just causes. This is what the leftists and Marxists are. Thieves who came along, let me be more precise here, the theoreticians and the ideologues of the left and socialism and Marxism, they came along and observed this transfusion of wealth from the mass of people into a few pockets and a few personalities in different societies and in different countries. And so they began, in the absence of our will, in the absence of our understanding of the Quran, they began to poison the door of the minds of the oppressed and the minds of the Muslims, because the Muslims themselves, they abandoned these meanings in the Quran. In the Quran, there are ayat that speak at length about this inequality. And the issue of Islam is settling into the human condition, the political supremacy of Allah's system. This is our task if we are Muslims. It's not just a simple task to be a Muslim, to come and perform five prayers a day, and then go out to society as if there is no dislocations and inequalities and inequities and oppression, as is obvious in the human condition today, around the globe. This is not the task of Islam. The task of Islam is a serious task. Understanding the meanings of these ayat and then trying to identify reality from the light that is shed from these ayat on our lives and the surroundings and the environment around us. When Allah says, مَا أَفَاءَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْقُرَىٰ فَلِلَّهِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِذِي الْقُرْبَىٰ كَيْ لَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ. There has to be a circulation of money. There has to be a breakdown of capital. According to these ayat in the Quran, there cannot be a deen of Allah, a system from Allah that is functioning in this world, and at the same time, there's a tremendous buildup of wealth with a very few people, and then a tremendous accumulation of poverty and dispossession with the majority, overwhelming majority of the other people. In this situation, Allah's deen doesn't exist. Criteria functioning of human reason, if we didn't have the faculty of reasoning and thinking, the message would not be applicable to us. Allah's system would not be our responsibility. For what? What's the purpose of all of this? To come and pray 5 times a day and then forget about the world around you? Allah gives you the reason. لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. So that people, so that justice may be landed among the people, so that people may rule in a just fashion. This is the purpose of Allah's revelations, of Allah's books, and the faculty of reasoning and thinking. إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون لأولي الألباب لعلكم تتفكرون إن في ذلك لذكرى. And the rest of these ayat that try to bring your attention and your focus, the responsibility of activating your will and your reason, and then relating the world around you to the system that has been given to you by Allah. So Allah grants you this system. Why should there be, and this system is a political economic system in nature, as much as the enemies of Allah subhanahu want to give derogatory meaning to politics and economics. The ayat of the Quran are replete with politics and economics. Are part of our faith. When we come and repeat the ayat in our prayers 5 times a day, how do we repeat them and then leave the masjid to encounter the opposite meanings of these ayat in the world around us? So the responsibilities of the prophets and messengers was one of change, to change this world. And they ran into opposition. Why should there be any opposition? If the Christians and the Jews were in the forefront of opposing Allah's system, Allah's deen, Allah's manhaj, why should they be so opposed to it if there is no political system as far as Christianity is concerned? And if there is no combining of church and state as far as Christianity is concerned, why do we find this historical opposition coming from the imperialists? And once again, that doesn't lend itself to the connotations of the people who most often use this word. Why is it then that they oppose us? There is no political system in their belief. Why can't they let the Muslims go ahead with their job in this world and establish the system of Allah subhanahu? Because obviously this system of Allah threatens their egos, their greed, their capital, their status, their power, and their privilege. And why do you think the prophets and the messengers of Allah Azza wa Jalla throughout the years were opposed by rulers, by kings? And why do you think that the followers of divine direction are opposed today by the systems of the status quo? It is because they have synchronized their will and their understanding with the ayat of Allah that identify the issues of life around us. I hope there is not a Muslim that will leave the masjid thinking that he is free of challenging the oppression that permeates this world today, whether it is an immediate tyranny, which everyone has in his immediate surrounding, or whether it's more of a global nature. It is our responsibility to change, not according to our whims. Allah subhanahu gave us a program by which we initiate this change. But don't think you can do this by day. had to go to the war front. He had to engage in battles and confrontations to bring about this change. Who can claim that he is more successful and he can have done what the Prophet had done without going to the battlefields, without contemplating in a very serious manner?
Islamists is the opposite. Whoever can
changing, Monica should do so in his heart, and he can do more than that. He should do so with his pen or with his verbal skills, and whoever can do more than that should do it by the application of force. You see, the conventional understanding of Islam is a defeatist understanding. This is not the way the Prophet talks. But what happened? Why is this hadith quoted so many times? And then we understand it in a way that wasn't meant by the Prophet. What happens? Once again, our will is hibernating. We don't have a will that is working in this world. And then when some Muslims muster that will, and alhamdulillah, we are witnessing a new era in which this process is coming on stronger and stronger as the months pass by, what do we see? It is exactly as if the Muslim Ummah as a whole is testing the water. When you first put your foot into the sea to see how cold the water is, take it or can't you take it? Are you able to tolerate it or are you not able to tolerate it? But once you plunge into that water, you can tolerate it. And the use of force can be tolerated by the Muslims. When we begin to use force, we can continue to use force as we are taught by the Quran and by the Sunnah of the Prophet. How many ayat in the Quran are speaking about military encounters? Look at the nature of Surah Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam and Surah Al-Fatih. The military cadence of Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasalam. And then the political atmosphere of Surah Al-Fatih. Today, I may mention this, Surah Muhammad and Surah Al-Fatih, it doesn't ring a bell. Where is their military atmosphere? Where is their political climate in these surahs? This is how far away we are from understanding the Quran. We do not have the ability to reconstruct the political and economic realities of the days of the Prophet and then see them today, live and kicking around us, that are begging us to challenge them. How do we challenge them? By daydreaming, by wishful thinking, by lip service. Or do we challenge them with our will? And Allah guarantees us, once our will comes into existence, we shall not be defeated. And the low-intensity war in the media against this will is precisely for that matter, not to see an Islamic determination in this world, to try to defeat us more than we are defeated. Where is the attitude of those who are fighting for the cause of Allah and they want to die more than they want to live? This was the character of the generations that came into existence with if they did not try to sacrifice their lives for the cause of Allah. They had to court death itself to be satisfied that they exist. These meanings of the Quran are alien to us today. And we should only blame ourselves. If the Marxist finds fertile grounds for stealing these issues, why did we permit you to steal? Why can't we identify these problems and then solve them in the light of the Quran? And then establish the system of Allah Jalla wa Ala in this world. This is our responsibility, to establish the economic and political system of Allah throughout this world. And then people may believe or have the creed or the faith that they want. We are not responsible for changing their faiths, although we would like very much for them to be guided. But if they insist on being Christians or Jews or and change the way they believe, and we are not responsible for that. We present Islam to them. If they accept it, fine. If they don't, they are accountable for their own lives. فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Allah gave the choice to man. Whoever chooses Iman, fine. Whoever chooses Kufr, fine. In as far as belief is concerned. But in as far as a system of life, Allah does not accept from Islam. إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The system that is sanctioned by Allah in this world is Islam. The rules and the regulations that should engulf the whole world are the rules and regulations of the deen of Allah. This is our responsibility. Why should they challenge us for this? There is no Christian competition for a worldwide system that is economically Christian or politically Christian, because they have no economics and no Christianity in as far as a global reach of understanding is concerned. But we do. يُرِيدُونَ. The Prophet was quoting this from the Quran. يُرِيدُونَ لِيُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. So that this system may become superior over all other systems. In this world, on a global scale, this is the ambition of the Muslim. ولو كره المشركون. Even though the mushriks may hate it, and it is natural that they will. So what? If they say we are terrorists, so what? What do you expect from the enemy of Islam to say about you? You want to be praised by the enemies of Islam, by Yahud, by the Mushrikeen, by the Kafirs? We cannot expect this. Of course, they're going to try to dig up all the terminology and the words that they have in their different languages and label us with them. And this should be a source of pride for us. What have we done? What are we doing that is wrong? We challenge, as Muslims, revolutionary in nature and activist in direction. We challenge these people who are labeling the different Muslims in this world with these different labels. What is wrong with a Muslim wanting to live like any other human being? What is wrong with a Muslim materializing his will by acts of war? There's an ayah in the Quran, inshallah, I'll be speaking about this later, that means, if I fight, I exist. And look at the Muslims. How many are there Muslims in this world? Conservative, a billion. Almost one-fourth of the human species are Muslims. But do they exist? Do we exist for practical purposes? Do we, sincerely, in your heart of hearts, do Muslims have an existence in this world? يوشك أن تداعى عليكم الأمم كما تداعى الأكلة إلى أصحابها. قالوا ومن قلة نحن يومئذ يا رسول الله. قال لا أنتم كثير ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل. لينزعن الله من قلوب أعدائكم المهابة منكم وليغلبن في قلوبكم الوهن. قالوا وما الوهن يا رسول الله؟ You are on the verge to be sought out from among the nations of the world as a hungry beast would seek out a prey, some food to eat. The people around the Prophet God's peace was the one. Isn't that we are few? That's the only thing that comes to mind. Muslims may be few. A woman could have never been only thing else for one. He said, no, there's many of them. Look at us there in this world. Many of us. But the kingdom of Allah will know that same. But you are foam, equivalent to the foam of a running stream. The stream runs this way, the foam goes with it. Runs that way, the foam follows. This is where we are going. The Marxists dictate this. We captain say this, we obey. Where's Allah in all of this? Allah will extract the aura that you have from the hearts of your enemies. The Muslims have an aura in the hearts and in the minds of their enemies. Allah is going to take that away. It's gone. Do we see it today? Unless there's a revolutionary circumstance, we see it. But besides that, we don't see it. He will instill a wahan into your heart. He asked, what is a wahan? The Messenger of Allah, he said, it sums it up, these two words. The affair that you have with this world and the hate that you have towards death. This sums it up. You leave the masjid, you go to your store, you go to your business, you're involved in all of that, but you don't want to die. This is how, so you don't exist. You're like foam. Nothing. People can do what they want to you. But when one person determines, he puts his will into action, a dynamite truck driver explodes and ignites a truck in the barracks of the United States Marine Force in Lebanon. The whole policy of the United States changed regarding Lebanon. One person, وَكَمْ مِنْ فِيَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِيَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And how many times is it true that a numerically inferior amount of people triumph over a numerically superior amount of people with Allah's lead, with Allah's permission? Today, the Muslims exist where they are applying their will, where they are courting death. Not afraid of that. They have no qualms, no questions asked. Allah has presented to them an alternative to this life of non-existence. We don't exist. Yahud in this world, 14, 15 million of them. You see them in the television. They are the commentators. They are the newsmakers. They are the people who set costumes and fashions into motion. And they bring them out of style. They bring them back into style. And they are playing havoc with the norms and with the values of humanity. One-fourth of humanity are victims to this process because we cannot muster our will to court death. So what? It's only a minute and you surrender your life and you go to a presence that is better than this. فيها ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر ألهم الطلعت عليه. In the place that Allah has reserved for you, if you are willing to do so, court death, proceed to die. In it there are things that eye has never witnessed, that ears have never heard, that hearts have never sensed, besides all of that that you are familiar with. What type of incentive can Allah give you? What type of incentive in the Quran can Allah present to you? How can He attract you to His presence? What do you ask of Allah? Like many Israel, you want Him to descend among us and lead the struggle Himself. Let us not fall in the pitfalls of many Israel. They maneuvered the issue of fighting throughout their history. Let us not maneuver this issue and then wind up with the same circumstances and the resultants of Bani Israel. We shall not have an excuse in the presence of Allah. And